have to be in such a good mood.
I think that it's very hard to lead a decent life and to live in a way that you feel good about. But I believe that decent people try every day, and that this group, which is essentially a decent group, would have been all right.
Sarah, Harold, we took a secret vote. We're not leaving. We're never leaving.
One of the first ideas for The Big Chill that I had was that the movie would end with a flashback to the same group in college on Thanksgiving Day. And you would see the life they had been talking about up till then in the movie. And you would see Alex, who has been missing from the whole movie, the suicide, you would actually see him and what part he played in this group. You would get to compare their memories that you'd been hearing for the first hour and 45 minutes of the movie with the reality that you would see in the flashback. We shot this flashback first. We were in Atlanta and we fixed up a house to look like a house in Ann Arbor, Michigan, where I had gone to school. And everyone was in their 60s makeup and hair and wardrobe. And we shot this scene of them making Thanksgiving dinner. And it was a wonderful, after 4 weeks of rehearsal, it was a wonderful sort of crystallization of everything we had been talking about, what it was like to be live in a commune, what it would have been like if they'd all lived together during that time. It sealed that feeling of friendship. And when we cut the flashback together and put it on the end of the movie and showed it not to a public audience but to a group of friends, we discovered that it totally confused the movie.
Too much history, it's not right.
We had already accrued in the movie all the benefits of that flashback without actually having to see it. So it was a lucky mistake, I think, that we went ahead and shot the flashback even though we wound up cutting it. The most painful part was that the actor I had cast as Alex was Kevin Costner. He had done very little at that time. He'd been only in Testament and a few low-budget films. And he was wonderful as Alex, very charismatic. As you can see, he went on to be very charismatic. And he did good work in that flashback. And when I cut the flashback, he disappeared. The only remnant of him in the movie is that it's his hairline and parts of his body being dressed at the beginning of the film.
I never know what to wear to these things. All my black stuff is sexy.
Aside from this big chunk of the flashback, there were several scenes we took out simply for pace, or at the time they didn't seem necessary, and they're mainly comedy scenes, and mainly prior to the funeral service in the church. And I think we took them out because we felt they slowed the first part of the movie down.
And you were so good to me when I came home with Alex. Some of the best memories I have are of sitting around your kitchen table eating that wonderful... What was that? Was that stew or what?
I think that The Big Chill came from the best possible instincts in my filmmaking life, which was it was purely personal. I wanted to tell a very specific story about people of my generation. I had no thought of how popular it would be or how many people would relate to it. When a film gets an enormous response the way The Big Chill did, when not only my generation but younger people and older people related to it in a powerful way, you're thrilled because that's your highest hope for something, that you've told something so specific that it can be universal for people. Doesn't always happen, but in that case it did, and I was very surprised and very delighted.